Allahu Akbar.
Clap if you're happy to be Muslim. Let me hear you. Let me hear you. See, sometimes I do that at the airport. I'm just happy to be Muslim. I'm just standing like, can we help him? Like, I always talk about Muslims being disrupted. Listen, I'm going to tell you guys, I've been Muslim a long time. I try to give dawah, but sometimes it's hard. Sometimes you got to be honest. People get on your nerves when you're Muslim. Isn't that right? Keep it real. They get on your nerves. A little while back, I'm on a flight. Early morning, I'm trying to make dawah on the flight. I can't make it because the lady beside me, she was a nice lady. She's a white lady. That wasn't the problem. She was nosy. That was the problem. I'm trying to make dawah. She's talking all the way through my dawah like we're in a documentary. I'm trying to make dua, she's talking, she's like, oh, what's going on here? What's he doing? This looks interesting. Why does a black man have his hands in the air? Is he robbing himself? And I realized making dua is making this lady nervous, so just to be a jerk, I made the dua longer. At one time, I wasn't even praying, I just had my hands in the air. Finished making dua, then she wants to have a conversation. And I'm trying to, I finished. She's like, excuse me, sir. I was like, yes, can I help you? She goes, yes, you were doing something? I was like, I do a lot of things, lady. She says, no, you had your hands in the air. And I realized when somebody's about to insult you Muslims, this is the move they do sometimes. I was like, lady, can I help you? She goes, yes, you had your hands in the air. I was like, yeah, you said that before. She said, what was going on? Now, I could have just told her I was praying, but I decided to be super Muslim. She's like, what were you doing? I was like,
I was making dua.
That's the way I said it.
Making dua.
Sometimes I put an extra syllable in it.
I was making dua.
She was like, oh, that's great. That's wonderful. She goes, well, oh, that's super. You're making dua. What's dua? I was like,
I was praying to my Lord.
And she goes overboard. Oh, you were praying. That's wonderful. I prayed too. We could have prayed together. We could have had a prayer group. We missed out. Oh, you pray. That's wonderful. She goes, you are a Christian, aren't you? I was like, not anymore. She was like, oh, so you're not Christian. She goes, you don't look Jewish. I'm like, yeah, you didn't look stupid before you said that. She's like, so what religion are you? I didn't even say religion. I just looked at her and I said,
I'm Muslim.
She's like, oh, wow. So what were you praying for? I was like, you. I don't care. People annoy me. They talk about Muslims all the time. Muslims are scary. Muslims are... No, they're not. You know, Muslims want to be disruptive. I'm a disruptive Muslim. One day you're going to turn on CNN. You know what I'm going to be doing? I'm going to be praying in the middle of 84. I don't care. Me, shut up, I'm making fodder. People worry about Donald Trump. He's the president of the United States. He's not gardener of the universe. You know what I mean? Donald Trump, I don't even call him Donald Trump. You know what I call him? I call him White ISIS. ISIS looked at Donald Trump like, we are out of work. And I tell Muslims, you know what? Stop worrying, have a plan. If Donald Trump makes it to be inaugurated, have a plan. I have an exit strategy. If he gets to be president in January, you know what I'm going to do? As soon as they swear him in, I'm going to call an Uber, and I'm going to go back to my homeland of Pakistan. You guys are laughing. Next time you see me, I'm going to be in one of these helping hand videos. Making dua with the little black kids. Some of y'all are like, Astaghfirullah. Shut up, that's funny. How you doing, sir? I'm telling you, Muslims, enjoy yourself. Now, the imams have a sense of humor. Muslims, you got to have a sense of humor. One of my favorite imams is Imam Zaid Chaker. Do you know Imam Zaid Chaker? In the toughest of times, he can make a joke. A couple years ago, we were doing a fundraiser, and this is what happened, true story. I'm sitting at a table with all of these knowledgeable scholars and their wives. What happened was I got up to do my show. I left my hat on the table with my iPhone in it, finished the show, came back to the table. My hat was there. iPhone was gone. Someone stole my iPhone. And I was upset, but I couldn't say anything because I was around all these pious Muslims. So I was like, gosh darn it, shucks. Pooey. But the people knew I was upset, and they thought I was going to go off, like break something or something. So they sent Imam's aid over to make me feel better. He walks over. He said, Preacher Moss. I'm like, yes, sir. He says, Preacher Moss. He said, I have good news and bad news about your iPhone. I said, okay, Sheikh. I said, what's the bad news? He said, your iPhone is gone. I said, what's the good news? He said, all things come from Allah. All things return to Allah. I'm like, Sheikh, I'm not trying to hear that. I just got robbed. I'm petty. I am petty. Day of judgment, Yom Kiyama, if I'm standing in line, I see somebody with my iPhone, I'm getting out of line. Hold my spot, man. I want my phone back. So y'all laughing. That's good, man. That's good, you know. Did the fundraiser go okay? The fundraiser go okay? Yeah, I go to live fundraisers, man. I could probably do a new show called Fundraisers Gone Wrong. I was at one fundraiser. It was in Toledo, Ohio. Let's keep it real, people. The masjid was like, it was in the hood. It was like in the hood. Like Maghrib came 30 minutes early. It was in the hood, and they bought this fundraiser dude. He didn't pay attention to the environment and the decoration of the hood. He comes in the masjid. He just wants to start fundraising. He just walks up in front of the people. He goes, to begin the fundraising, I'd like to see someone give me $50,000. Somebody yelled out from the back, me too. Now, my favorite fundraiser was a couple years ago, and the reason I liked it was because it had two fundraisers. The first guy came up, he was about this tall. We couldn't even see him. When he got behind the podium, we couldn't even see him. He started talking. I thought it was my conscience talking to me. He's like, Salaikum, Salaikum. I was like, where is that voice coming from? Now, the second fundraiser they brought up, oh, he was a gangster. I love this guy. He was from Saudi Arabia. He had been in the country like 15 minutes. I don't know what version of Rosetta Stone he got in a hold of, but it wasn't working that night. All I know was he was confident. I like confident Muslims. Who cares about his English? He was confident, and I know he was a bad man, because the first thing he did when he stepped on stage was he stroked his beard for 15 minutes. And then he spoke. Salaikum. Salaikum. Listen to me. Why do Muslim men get a microphone and go, listen to me? We can't help but listen to you. That's the objective of the microphone. Listen to me. I was like, I hear you. Then he started, okay, this is fundraiser. We need the money. You have the money. You're gonna give it to me. I was like, oh my gosh, this guy's magic. Then he goes overboard on the school. We're gonna build a school. It's gonna be a Muslim school. It's gonna have Muslim children in it, Muslim teachers in it, Muslim books in it. Muslim paper in it, Muslim pencils in it, Muslim desk in it, and three black children. Alhamdulillah. It's a wonderful school. That's good. You're laughing. I like that. You know, some Muslims here, there's a comedian, and they would sit right down front and focus on not laughing the whole show. They sit here like this. I had a guy like that. 2,000 people in the audience, 1,999 Muslims laughing, one brother in the front row trying to hold it in. I mean, he's acting like if I made him laugh, he was going to break his wudu. I finally got him to laugh. I after like, you know, 45 minutes, he laughed. He made me think he hadn't laughed in about 45 years. I got him laugh, it sounded like this. I was like, oh my God, that's just plain nasty. That is horrible. Tell Muslims, enjoy yourself. Got all these rumors about people in our community. They say our women are oppressed. Muslim women are oppressed. That's not true. I married a Muslim woman. I'm oppressed. Some of you brothers want to laugh. Were you with your wife?
It's not fitting alone.
That brother clapping. You're going to be walking home tonight. She has the keys. Like, come back. It's a long walk to New York. Come back. It's all right. I tell Muslims, enjoy yourself. Have a good time. You know what in America, man, what do I learn about this election? Like, people don't work their problems out anymore. Like, I'm old school. We used to work problems out. And I can tell people aren't used to it. You know why? Because they have TV shows for folks who can't work problems out. You ever see the court TV shows? There's too many of them. It's a gazillion of them. You got Judge Judy, Judge Alex, Judge Joe Brown, Judge Mathis, Divorce Court, Animal Court. I hope Muslims don't get a court TV show, because you know what they're going to call it. Sharia Court. And I'm totally against Sharia Court unless they let me be the judge in Sharia Court. Because if I'm the judge, you'll never want to come into my courtroom again. You know why? Because whoever's coming into my courtroom, I don't care what you did, you're getting 25 years in prison. I don't care. Course in session with Judge Preacher Moss. First case. Your Honor, I got caught drinking. 25 years. What about you? Your Honor, I miss Fodger. 25 years. What about you? Your Honor, you don't remember me? Who are you? I'm the man to introduce you to your wife. Death. Some of you brothers want to laugh. Your wife is right there. I'm joking. No, fellas, please respect these sisters. Take care of these, protect your sisters. How many of you brothers are married? Hands went up slow. I was having fun. Stop. How many of you brothers want to get married? Just these three. Do it all together. Save on the Uber. It's all right, man. I'm going to tell you guys something. I'm telling all you brothers that are married, you brothers want to get married. Treat these sisters like queens. I'm going to tell you why. Because when a sister told her family that she wanted to marry you, I want you to know that she went all out for you. Isn't that right? She didn't go 100%. She went 150%. She built you up, fellas. She made you a little bit more than you actually are. I'm not saying she lied. I'm saying she exaggerated. Like, if you could plug something to a socket and not get electrocuted, to her, doggone it, you are an engineer. If you take a pill without choking, doggone it, you are a doctor. My wife got so excited with building me up, she forgot to tell her family I was black. You guys laugh. My wife is Indian. Look at the people.
Astaghfirullah. We hope he's lying.
Yeah, man. I went to go meet my wife's family. I walked through the door. They stared at me like I was the second coming of the Mississippi Masala. They were like,
what is going on here? We hope he's the cab driver.
We almost didn't get married, folks. We almost didn't get married. Not for reasons you're thinking about. I had never hung out with Indian, Pakistani people my whole life. I knew I was in trouble at dinner because they laid out all the food and they were like, why aren't you eating? Why aren't you eating? I was like, because I've been waiting 15 minutes for a fork. They're like, you don't need a fork. What do you want? You want some hummus? Here, take that. Want something to drink? Go ahead. The real reason we almost didn't get married is because my mother-in-law and I got into a huge fight. And it wasn't over what you're thinking. It wasn't over religion, race, even my job. We got into a huge fight over spices. because we have philosophical differences about spices. Like, to me, my hot is hot. She's Pakistani. Her hot is hell. And she put it all over the food, too. She pulled this potato thing out of the refrigerator. It darn near caught on fire. And she was like, Shamsuddin, you eat, you eat. I was like, Then my wife's feeling all pressure. What are you doing? Everybody's watching. Why aren't you eating? We're trying to get married. You're not being a team player. Just eat it, eat it. I was like, hey, I don't love you that much, girl. Right then, the phone rings. It's my mom calling to see how things are going. Bring, 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 bring. Wife picks up the phone. She starts snitching on me immediately. Hello? Hey, Yasmin, girl, how's it going? Girl, are you crying? Mm-hmm. What's wrong? It's him. What did him do? Well, my mom made this potato thing, and he won't eat it because he says it's too hot, and we're trying to get married, and I love him, but he's not cooperating. Boo-hoo-hoo. My mom's like, put him on the phone. I get on the phone. I'm like, what's going on, mama? She's like, don't you want some going on, mama, with me? What's going on with those people, boy? I said, Mom, they're real nice people. She said, stop messing with me. I said, here's the deal, Mom. They're real nice people. The mom made this food, and I think she put gasoline in it. Then my mom breaks me down. Listen here, young man. I don't care what that lady put in that food. You listen to me. If she stood over a hot stove to fix you something to eat, doggone it, you're going to eat it. Do you understand me? I raised you better than that. I'm going to tell you something. I don't care if that lady put ketchup on a boot. You're going to eat it. Do you hear me? Or I will kill you. So I was like, well, you know what? Let me just take one for the team. I was like, it's no problem. I'm going to do this potato thing. It's no problem. So I took the potato, and I threw it in my mouth. I chewed. It's not that bad. And as soon as I said that, I couldn't hear. I was like, people were talking. Closed my eyes, and I saw Jesus. And for a minute, I went back to being Christian. I was like, Lord, help me. Then it gets worse. I had to use the restroom. Now, I'm being honest. First time in Indian Pakistani restroom. I'm going to keep it real with you. I was in that restroom 45 minutes. You know why? Because I didn't know what a lotah was. I'm sitting here going, this is a weird place to want to take a drink of water. Come out of the restroom. I know the odds are against me. Nobody in my wife's family likes me. And I'm telling you, fellas over in the corner, if that happens to you, don't worry. Don't worry. If nobody in the family likes you, don't panic. This is important. Forget about everybody. As long as the grandma likes you, you are in. And my wife's grandmother loved me. We got along well. You know why? Because she didn't speak English. I didn't speak Urdu, let the games begin. We're having a whole conversation with no subtitles. I'm like, Grandma, we get married, you're gonna see a lot of me. She's like, chi chi, chi chi, chi chi, chi chi. I said, we can kick it and hang out. She's like, ah, cha, chi chi, chi chi, chi chi. And then she wanted to speak. I was like, what's up, Grandma? She's like, yeah. And I leaned in, I was like, what do you want to tell me? This is where it got crazy. I leaned in, and she blew her breath in my face. I was like, what's up, Grandma? She's like, I was like, what do I do here? Do I blow back? Because I had that potato, I'll kill this old lady. It's all good, you know. Me and my mother-in-law, we're good now, you know. My wife's family, we're all cool. You know why? Because we have one daughter. Children make everything smoother. That's right. We have one daughter. Her name is Miriam. Love her to death. You know, because she's smart. I like her, you know, because I raised her in my mold. That's in my mold. Yeah, she came home from school one day last year. She had a long face. I said, what's up, baby? I said, was somebody trying to be Islamophobic around you? She said, no, daddy. I said, what's wrong? She said, daddy, this boy walked up to me. I said, what'd he say? He said, he asked if he could be my boyfriend. I said, word? She was like, word. I said, what'd you say? I told him no, daddy. I said, that's right. I said, well, did you tell him why? I said, yeah. I said, you can't be my boyfriend because I'm a Muslim. I was like, that's my girl. I said, what else do you tell me? And I told him, you could be my boyfriend because my daddy will kill you. I was like, that's right. That's my girl. Yeah, you know, but when my daughter was born, man, my father-in-law was so happy. The family was so happy. You know why? Because when she was born light. For real, my father-in-law was outside the living room. He was making dua. He was like, Gora, Gora, Gora. So I'm telling y'all to have fun, you know, because for me, I wasn't always Muslim. I guess you can figure that out. I wasn't always Muslim, but this is how much I love the religion. I wasn't Muslim. I used to fake Muslim. I used to fake it till I make it. I did, for real. You know, when I became Muslim, it's funny because, first of all, I was hanging out with brothers who were in the Nation of Islam, and I love those brothers because they knew how to talk to American oppressors without going to jail. Whatever they said it twice, and you knew it was important. Guy walked up to me, he changed my whole life. He just walked up to me, he said, this is what he said. He said, all black man, my brother, yes, yes. Young soldier, that's all he said. It was powerful. I'm telling you, brothers, that's how I got my wife. I didn't need a Wale. I was like, oh, my sister, I'm gonna marry you. We're gonna have babies. Yeah, but you know, the same guy is the one that actually got me to Islam. You know, I was gonna be Muslim, but it happened where I took my Shahada like 3 months earlier than I planned. Because you know, when Muslims think somebody's going to convert, they just want to kick them over the edge. I'm sitting in the masjid, this brother walks up to me, he's like, oh, black man, my brother, yes, yes, young soldier. He said, what are you doing, black man? I was like, I'm reading the Quran, because I was hard, I'm reading the Quran. He's like, easy. He said, what are you reading? I said, I'm reading Al-Fatiha. That's what he said, Al-Fatiha. Like I wanted to fight Al-Fatiha. He was like, oh man. He said, let me hear it. I was like, really, you want to listen? He said, yeah. I said, all right, and I said it. And he just said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Black man, stop. I said, what's up? He says, man, that is the most beautiful thing I've heard all day. I was like, really? He said, yeah. He said, have you tried Shahada? I was like, what's Shahada? He was like, repeat after me. I wound up taking my Shahada 3 months early, and I got to tell my mom, I'm petrified. My mom's Christian, and I felt bad, so I was scared. I didn't want to tell my mom. And first of all, the funny thing is, if anybody converted, you know you fall in love with the language. The Quran is there, but you fall in love with the language. I was so excited. My three favorite phrases, and I wore them out. My three favorite phrases were As-salamu alaykum, wa alaykum as-salam, and I used to say them together. I used to walk up a Muslim, assalamu alaikum, alaikum assalam. They'd be like, that's my part. Shut up, I'm new. My other word was kafaholic. I wore that one out. My mom was like, baby, I need to talk to you. I was like, kafaholic, mama. She's like, I care for alcoholics too, baby. Now, the word that got me in trouble was the word deen, spelled D-E-E-N. The reason it got me in trouble was because I didn't tell my mama I was Muslim right away. I was scared. I didn't tell her. What I did was I left clues. The problem is I left really bad clues. Yeah, here are the clues I left for my mom. Stop drinking, stop chasing the ladies, and I started hanging out with a lot of dudes. She didn't think I was Muslim. She thought I was confused. We're at dinner one day, I'm trying to tell my mom I'm Muslim, she thinks it's a whole different story. Like, mama, I need to talk to you? She's like, mm-hmm. You sure do need to talk to mama, mm-hmm. I've been waiting on this conversation. I said, Mom, I need to make some changes in my life. She's like, I know you have, but Mama's here for you. I'm holding on to the rope of Jesus. I said, Mom, I stopped drinking. She said, that's good, that's good. I said, the girls don't call the house anymore. She said, I didn't like any of them. I said, I've been hanging out with these brothers getting information. She said, oh, is that what they call it now? I go off on my mom because I'm not getting the right reaction. I'm like, Mama, I don't care what you think. I'm a grown man. I make my own decisions. She said, what are you trying to tell me, Mike? I'm like, Mama, just listen. She said, what are you trying to tell me? I said, Mama, I don't care what you think. I'm a grown man. I make my own decisions. She said, what are you trying to tell me? I said, Mama, she said, what? I said, I got Dean in my life. She's like, who is Dean? Don't you bring Dean around here. I will kill you indeed. Mom got the information all mixed up. The worst part about it, she gets my dad worked up. You know, my dad, he's old school, cool black man, old school. But when he gets excited, the words don't come out the way it's supposed to. My dad's excited. He walks up to me. He wants to say, hey, son, what's going on? Your mama's crying. Talk to me. What's going on? It didn't come out like that. It came out like this. But hey, what the hey, bro? Your mama crying, but you okay? He's like, no, Pops, Mom done listen. I'm a Muslim now. I'm a Muslim, Pops. Dean means faith. Dean means faith. He's like, hold on a minute. Mary, you got it all wrong, woman. The boy is seeing a woman named Faith. In the Muslim community, this is what I love. We always have brothers who want to help you. The problem is you didn't ask for the help. I took my shahada. This brother walked up to me. He's like, here's my card. I said, what's your card for? He goes, take my card. He goes, when you're ready to be a good Muslim, you call me. I didn't know it was a business. And just for the heck of it, I called him one Saturday. I was like, you know what? This is a good day to be a good Muslim. I called him. I was like, hey, brother, it's Preacher Moss. Just took my shahada. Ready to be a good Muslim. Can you help me? He's like, yes, come over to my house right away. I went over to his house. He said, are you ready to be a good Muslim? I said, yeah. He said, you ready? I said, give it to me. He said, you ready? I said, give it to me. People, he gave me a piece of mishwack. I said, what do I do with this? He said, put it in your mouth. I did. He said, you look Muslim already. Look at that. No directions, no instructions. That miswack was as long as my arm, people. I didn't know you could cut it. I'm walking around Washington, D.C. with a whole tree coming out of the side of my mouth. My father's like, hey, Mary, the boy's eating trees. He was with Jesus. He's eating trees now. Yeah, I mean, our brothers always want to help. There's always a brother in the masjid that wants to be in charge of something. Like, I don't know if this happened to your masjid. It might not. But every Friday, everybody comes to Juma. We're in Juma. We're listening to the imam. He's giving the khutbah. We're all dialed in. We're focusing. And out of nowhere, this brother just walks up to the front of the masjid to tell everybody to move up. He just walks up. And then he just walks out. He doesn't even pray. He's been doing this 35 years. I don't even think he's Muslim. I think he just walks up, tells Muslims to walk back, and then he goes back to his job at the airport. All right. So where's the MC? Where's the MC? Did he leave? MC left. He couldn't take the pressure. It's all right. So, I hope you guys don't mind. They told me I'm supposed to tell an inspirational story about being Muslim. All right, that's not gonna happen. Hey, thank you. You make it, sir. Thank you. We tried to wait till you came, but thank you for coming. Are you the Uber driver for those guys? So I want to tell you guys the most important story about being Muslim I could tell you. This is a classic story. Some of you have heard it. Don't ruin it for others. It's a classic story. Now I'm going to start it out by saying I'm an old school Muslim. Old school. I'm Sunni Muslim. But I got a Nation of Islam spirit. I'm an old school Muslim, which means that when I became Muslim, I wanted it. Like back in the day, you know, if you took a picture of yourself, it wasn't a selfie, it was just selfish. But what I remember, when I first saw my shahada, with an old black man, he was like, look at here, black man. I was like, yes, sir. He goes, whatever you do, brother, whatever you do, on a Friday, you get to God's house, you get to Allah's house. You hear me, brother? Get to Allah's house. He's talking about Juma. And that was almost 30 years ago. Every Friday, it doesn't matter where I go, I travel all over the world in this country, I still try to get to Juma. But there was this one time, and I'm talking about old school, back in the day when you were trying to find a masjid or whatever, even Muslims, they didn't have the internet. There was no apps. You wanted to find Muslims or masjid, you had to get in the yellow pages. Start at the M's for Muslims, Muslims, Mediterranean restaurants, Islam, church, try them all, man. But I went to this one masjid, it was in the Pacific Northwest, and I remember this clearly, changed my life. This story might change yours. I went to this masjid, people opened the door, and I'm gonna keep it real with you because we're family at this point in time. I opened the door, and it was 99.9% Indian Pakistani brothers and sisters. That 1%, it was one black guy. He was in the parking lot. He was on security. So I'm walking up. He let everyone in the masjid, but he stopped me. I'm like, "Assalamu alaikum, brother." He's like, "Walaikum assalam." I was like, "What's happening, brother?" He goes, "Are you Muslim?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "How long you been Muslim?" At this point, I said, "About 10 years." He goes, "Do you like it?" I said, "No, I was going to quit next week, man. That's all right." I said, "Can I go in?" He goes, "Well, let me tell you what's going to be going on." I'm like, "What's going on, brother?" He said, "You see the people behind me going in the masjid?" I said, "Yes, sir." He's like, "Let me tell you what they're going to be doing." I said, "What are they going to be doing?" He said, "See those people?" I said, "Mm-hmm." He said, "Those people are going to be praying." I said, "I'm glad we worked that out. Can I go now?" He was like, "Well, what's the problem?" He goes, "Listen, I want to bring it up, but you're not from around here." I was like, "No, and neither are you. Can I go in now?" He's like, "Okay, all right, I'm gonna let you in." Then he gets deep on me. He says, "Listen, I'm gonna let you in, but I have to tell you something that's very, very important about this match. It's very important. You have to remember this." I was like, "What is it?" Now, people aren't getting upset because he's making me late. I don't like to be late for Juma. But I'm thinking, take your ego out of it. Don't be arrogant. Maybe he wants to give you some valuable information. Hadith, some sunnah, something from the Quran. I'm like, "Okay, brother, what does he want to tell me?" He goes, "This is very, very important." I was like, "What is it, brother?" He says, "It's very important." I was like, "It must be profound. Ooh." I said, "Brother, what is it?" He said, "You must remember this." I said, "What is it?" "This is very important." I said, "I know it's important. What is it?" He said, "Before you go to masjid, remember this." I said, "What is it, brother?" People, he looked at me and goes, "Before you go to masjid, remember. Do not wear your shoes in the wudu area." I'm like, "What?" He goes, "Do not wear your shoes in the wudu area." I'm like, "Brother, I'm in the parking lot. Can I wear them in the parking lot?" And I was upset, people. I was ticked off, you know. But I was thinking, this Negro has lost his mind. But what he said kept playing in my head over and over. And I was like, it has a ring to it. I could use this one day. Like the next time they want a Muslim to come on television to defend Islam, I hope they call me. I hope it's Fox News. I hope it's Bill O'Reilly. He's going to preach them all. So we know you're a Muslim comedian. We don't care about that. What can you tell us about Muslim terrorism? I'm going to say, "Bill, sir, I can't tell you a thing about Muslim terrorism. But I can tell you this. Do not wear your shoes in the wudu area. Now, I'm trying to save lives here tonight. All you brothers, you know, we love our wives, and we want to protect them, but every once in a while you're going to have a disagreement, right? It happens. I'm not saying an argument, disagreement, and you're going to find yourself losing that argument and disagreement. Don't try and win that argument with logic. You're going to lose every time. When your wife goes in on you, we need to spend more time together. We need more money. My mom wants to move in forever. You look at her and say, hey, woman, hey. I don't know about that, but I can tell you this. Do not wear your shoes in the wudu area. Now listen, I gotta get ready to go. So I wanna give a shout out all you sisters. Thank you for coming out. Give yourselves a hand, sisters. Clap, good, that's enough. Fellas, give yourselves a hand. That's good. I also want to give a shout out to the Muslim spies that came out tonight. Muslim spies. Muslim spies? All right. I should call them Muslim. Call them what they are, the Haram police. The Haram police, you know they're here. I can say something right now. The Haram police will hear it. They'll run out in the lobby. They'll call the Haram police headquarters here in Hartford. Bring, 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 bring. Hello? Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam. What's going on? It's Preacher Moss. Oh my gosh. What's he doing? He's making Muslims laugh on purpose. Huh? No. We'll be right over. They get in the Haram police cars and they're going through the streets of Hartford and you can hear them three blocks away because their sirens sound like this. They get out of the cars, they try to arrest me and take off running. They start shooting at me, the guns sound like this. Bitter, 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 bitter. I get arrested, I'm on TV, I'm in Sharia court. Standing with the judge, my family. It's like, Preacher Moss, we find you guilty of making Muslims laugh on purpose. I sentence you to 25 years in prison. Before we take you away, is there anything you'd like to tell the courtroom? Well, Your Honor, now that you bring it up, I believe myself and my family would like to tell you something. Court stenographer, write this down. I try to be a good Muslim, try to be a good comedian. I don't know about that, but I can tell you this. Do it with me, family. Do not wear your shoes in the wudu area. Thank you very much, everybody. God bless. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much.